Good evening, and welcome. Welcome to this most special presentation by one of the world's most well-known psychologists, Dr. Philip Zimbardo. I'm David Baker, professor of psychology, the Margaret Clark Morgan Executive Director of the Cummings Center for the History of Psychology at the University of Akron. I want to welcome all of you from near and far for joining us this evening. Tonight's lecture is part of the 50th anniversary celebration of the Cummings Center for the History of Psychology, and I'm pleased and grateful that Dr. Zimbardo, who has and continues to make history, would make an effort to join us. As is the case with most highly successful and productive people, Dr. Zimbardo maintains a demanding and time-consuming schedule and was gracious enough to join us even though he had to fly from Budapest last night. I appreciate that more than I can say, especially since all I had to offer 1,100 of you, if he didn't show up, was Monday Night Football. A special thanks to Dorothy Gruitch of the Center for the History of Psychology. Dorothy worked triple time to make this evening possible, and this wouldn't have been able to happen without her efforts. Thanks also to the students and the staff of the center who always do whatever's needed. Dr. Zimbardo needs no introduction, but I'll provide a brief one, as we historians of psychology think that the backstory is an important one. Born in New York City, he received his undergraduate degree from Brooklyn College, and his PhD, we've got some people from Brooklyn, shout out to Brooklyn, and his PhD in psychology from Yale University, where Neil Miller was his advisor. From 1960 to 67, he was professor of psychology at New York University, and he joined the faculty at Stanford in 1968, where he is now professor emeritus. Now, I was talking with Dr. Zimbardo, you know, if you ever wanted to come back east, Akron is a wonderful place to settle. It's just like the Bay Area. And unlike New York City, the weather we have today, it's like this for 12 months a year. He's not buying it, is he? He became very well known for his 1971 Stanford prison experiment. And it is amazing to think that for more than 40 years, it continues to be discussed and debated, including the recent feature film of the same name. I was able to attend the opening of the film in Akron, and I want to say personally, Phil, how much I appreciate and respect your ever-present willingness to offer up an unflinching and candid appraisal of yourself and the Stanford prison experiment. At the Center for the History of Psychology, we have as our mission to examine what it means to be human. And that is something that Dr. Zimbardo has done throughout his career, and he's done so with distinction. In the best sense of giving psychology away, Dr. Zimbardo has always looked for ways to use psychology to help people. This includes his founding of the Shyness Clinic in the Bay Area, which treats shy behavior in adults and children. He hosted the very popular and successful series Discovering Psychology, and he is the co-author of Psychology in Life, an introductory psychology text that has served as the introduction to psychology for literally hundreds of thousands of undergraduate students. It is now in its 20th edition. It just so happens, you know, as a historian of psychology, I have the first edition of Psychology in Life. And I would tell you that this is my textbook when I was an undergraduate in my first psychology course in 1974. So I'm first in line at the book signing after your talk. But I paid for this like 40 years ago, so.
$25.
Yeah. Textbooks were a lot cheaper then. In addition to his text, his credits include over 50 books, 400 professional and popular articles and chapters. Some of his more recent works, The Lucifer Effect, The Time Paradox, and The Time Cure. He's also founder and president of the Heroic Imagination Project, which you'll be hearing more about tonight. In 2002, he was elected president of the American Psychological Association. In 2012, he received the American Psychological Association Gold Medal for Lifetime Achievement in the Science of Psychology. And finally, let me again add my personal thanks for Dr. Zimbardo's generous support of the center over these many years. Artifacts and documents from the Stanford Prison Experiment are on display at the center, as are many more items from his long and distinguished career. Without further ado, please welcome Dr. Philip Zimbardo.
Mm-hmm.
This is a wow for many reasons. Not only are there 1,100 people, it's the first time in my life I ever spoke in a triangular audience. So it's exciting to be here. I met some of you signing books earlier. I was happy to take selfies and sign books afterwards. But it's just amazing how many of you came from really far and wide to be here tonight. I am honored, and hopefully I'm going to do something which makes your trip worthwhile. I am going to do a number of things I have never, ever done before. I hope they work. And if not, then you'll forgive me and we'll move on to other things. So again, this is the 50th anniversary of the founding of the Center for the History of Psychology, which is unique in America. They have a wonderful building just down the street. They already have some wonderful exhibits, and it's going to be sensational once it's finished. I have donated all the paraphernalia from the Stanford Prison Study, and I will also donate all the archives that are at Stanford, not only about the prison study, but all the other research I've done. So with that, I want to begin. So I'm going to tell you a very personal story, and the personal story is my journey from creating evil to inspiring heroism. And I go from being under the influence of Darth Vader to being the Z-Man. I'm sorry to miss Santana's solo at the end. But essentially what I'm going to talk about is evil for the first part of my talk, and the second part I'm going to talk about heroes. And the question, what makes good people go wrong? So this is a question that has been asked for centuries. Philosophers, theologians, criminologists, ordinary people. Psychologists have not ever ask that question, because we don't ask mega questions. We ask questions that can be stated as a hypothesis. We ask questions that are fairly precise that we think we might be able to answer with experimental or correlational methods or with some new theory. But curiously, I've been asking that question since I was a little kid, since I was 7 or 8 years old. Why did I ask that question as a little kid? Because I was an intuitive psychologist before I knew psychology existed. And the reason is, this is where I grew up. This is the South Bronx, New York City, United States of America. Looks like a third world country, but this is the Bronx. Was and still doesn't look very much different. So if you grow up in any ghetto in the world, you are surrounded by men, it's always men, whose job it is to corrupt little kids for money. That is, to get you to sell drugs, take drugs, steal, for girls to sell their body. And some kids did it. So I had friends who I knew were good kids who got seduced by the lure of money. And some of them actually ended up in jail and ruined their whole life. But me and other friends didn't. So as a kid, I was wondering, what's the difference between us and them? Well, one answer was having a strong mother with a moral compass that said, don't do this, this is bad. And also having teachers in elementary school who gave the same message, that somebody cared for you. So that was part of it. The problem was also that I was just aware of this temptation. So if you're a middle class kid, you don't get tempted by offers of money because you whine and your parents give you your allowance. But if you're poor, you gotta work for it. And if you're a little kid, there's no jobs for you, so you give in to that temptation. Here's a picture of my playground in the South Bronx. And you see, we had to climb, on weekends, they closed the schoolyard. We had to climb that fence, really dangerous, to get in so we could play softball in the street. What's missing? So whenever you see an image, the two questions, what's in it that's compelling, And what should be there that's not there? This is a city in New York City, United States of America. What color is missing? The color missing is green. There's no flowers, there's no trees, there's no nature. So when you grow up poor, you grow up in the absence of nature. Okay? You grow up with concrete and steel, which is what prepares you to go to prison, because prisons are concrete and steel. So essentially, in this environment, which still exists, and this environment exists everywhere in ghettos around the world. In the United States of America, the richest country in the world, 21% of all children now grow up below the poverty line. That's one in five children in America, and obviously it's worse in many other countries, grow up whose families do not even meet the level of poverty line. So what difference does that make? They're a little poor. The difference is they die younger. Recent research showed that adults who grew up under adverse conditions, meaning economic poverty, that there were changes in their DNA. We used to think DNA was permanent. No, there's changes in your DNA. This is where nurture changes nature. Those changes in your DNA make you susceptible to all kinds of autoimmune diseases, diabetes, obesity, and others. It's called epigenesis. It's a change in the structure that turns on and off certain aspects of your DNA. And in this sense, poverty kills life. And there's now many other studies supporting that, that kids who grow up, children who grow up in poverty zones anywhere in America, elsewhere, their brains in utero are smaller than kids who grew up at advantage, partly because of the mother's malnourishment and many other reasons. The other question I asked myself as a kid that was stimulated by reading Robert Louis Stevenson's Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Because in that story, remember, here's the good Dr. Jekyll who invents a chemical he can't resist trying. When he does, he turns into this mad beast, Mr. Hyde. When the drug wears off, he crosses back over the line between good and evil. He becomes a good Dr. Jekyll again. And then he tries it once again. My friends wanted to know what was in the juice because they wanted to try it. I wanted to know about the line. Because I had been told by my mother, by the nuns in St. Anselm's Church, that there was a line separating good people like us and bad people like them. And that line was fixed. It was impermeable. So it was a secure thing. So if you knew you were good, there's no problem. But the story, even it was hypothetical. Nevertheless, as a kid, I said, hey, wait a minute. Could it be that that line is permeable, that it's not fixed? That good people could be seduced across that line, just like my friends did with these guys in the Bronx. And maybe it means that people who do bad things could be saved, could be rescued across that line. So again, I started thinking about, as a little kid, good and evil in this way. So there are many definitions of evil, obviously. A psychological definition has to do with power. For me, it's the intentional use of power. That you have this, whatever power you have, to harm people psychologically through sexist, racist jokes, through name calling, to harm people physically through torture, to hurt people, destroy through execution, through killing. And most evil is not done by people, it's done by systems. And that's where you get crimes against humanity. What we have ignored until very recently is the broader level of crime, not done by individuals, done by corporations. Fraud, corruption of all kind, indifference to climate change, which I'll talk about. In fact, most corporations have lawyers who convince our politicians not to vote for any kind of climate change legislation because they say it'll cost them money. So in the Lucifer effect, I go beyond what is usual in psychology. When we try to understand behavior as psychologists, what do we focus on? The person. It's the psychology of the individual. Thoughts, feelings, actions, motivations. But my sense is, as a social psychologist, again, as I say, same little kid, people are influenced by what's around them, by the situation, by circumstances. And that we are never actors on a stage. There's always an audience, a real audience, or in our head symbolically. And we are playing roles. We play roles all the time. When somebody says, what do? You say, I'm a teacher, I'm a parent, I'm a social worker. That's not who you are, but that's who you become over time. The role becomes you. And so I say that we have to focus not only on the individual, not only what the individual brings into the situation, your personality, your character, your ethnicity, your race, your religion, but what does the situation bring out of you? So that's the interaction, and that's what Kurt Lewin, father of social psychology, was talking about, the interaction between person and situation. It's not enough, because the question is, who makes that situation? Who keeps it going? So this is where the system comes in, and the system is where the action is, because that's legal, political, cultural, historical. And so I'm going to talk later on about the horrific things that some of our soldiers did in Abu Ghraib prison in Iraq. And if you remember, and I'll highlight it later, immediately the Bush administration and the government said, the work of a few bad apples. Whenever there's a scandal in any, in education, in police, environment, the people at the top will say, don't blame us, it's a few bad apples. I said, hey, maybe the apples were good if somebody put them in a bad barrel. And if so, I want to know who is the bad barrel makers. So it's a three-part analysis. What do people bring into the situation? We have to know. We have to know personality, background, we have to character. What does the situation bring out of the people? And then what is the system that maintains those situations and that can change them? Okay. So that's the focus we're going to have today. So the basic question, what makes ordinary people turn evil? We know. We have a recipe. In social cognitive personality psychology, each of those variables, you can't see them from way in the back, dehumanization, diffusion of responsibility, obedience to authority, group pressure, moral disengagement, and anonymity, de-individuation. There's been research on each of those. I'm going to talk about some of them in a few minutes. Any one of those is sufficient to get a number of people to cross that line between good and evil. And we've done this in many experiments, research. When you put them together, it's overwhelming. So that in most situations, I'm going to talk about the Milgram study where the majority, as you know, did bad things to an innocent stranger. I'm going to talk about the Stanford prison study where the majority of guards did bad things to innocent prisoners. But the same thing is true if you analyze the Holocaust, if you analyze virtually any situation, it's the majority that can be seduced across that line. The good news we'll get to is there's always a small percentage, a minority, who resist. And so the question is, what is it about those people that enables them to resist these enormous group pressures that pushes many of those most of us across that line? That's going to be one of the themes we're going to work on today. So I want to start with an example of systemic evil. With due apologies to any of you who happen to be from a Chinese background, but every year the Chinese government knowingly, willingly kills 1 million Chinese men. How can you say that? Very simple. Every year we know that 57% of all Chinese men smoke heavily, and 57% of the Chinese population amounts to 320 million men who smoke two or three packs of cigarettes a day. Curiously, only 2% of Chinese women smoke. It's the biggest gap in the world because smoking is seen as a masculine thing. So women don't do it, but men do it. So what does it mean? We now know from all the cancer statistics that of that 320 million men who smoke regularly, 1 million of them will die of lung cancer every year. Why does the government do it? They own the tobacco monopoly. They make 605 billion yen a year profit by having all these guys smoke. And nobody has confronted them with this simple statistic. What do they do with the money? Oh, great things. They have schools, they have charities, they have all kinds of programs. Oh, by the way, they control the media, so they suppress any anti-smoking campaigns. So if you're a Chinese man, you're stuck. You know, nobody's telling you all the bad things about it. People telling you all the good things. In fact, suppose you're a child in China and you went to one of these schools that the Chinese government supports from all the money they make on cigarette taxes. This, in fact, is a picture of the Sichuan Tobacco Primary School. And there's a plaque, if you could read Chinese in the corner. It says, ingenuity is the fruit of diligence. Yes, but tobacco will help you succeed. Little children going to that school are being seduced, mind controlled. They're saying tobacco is good for you. If the sign on the school says it, probably the teachers may have to say it. So you are now being brainwashed to think that smoking is good, at least if you're a guy. So this is, for me, the most extreme example of systemic evil in action. But there's other kinds of evil. I mentioned poverty as one, certainly war and genocide. But the UN just released statistics that said, in the past year, two of the worst evils that are increasing in every nation in the world are slave labor and sex trafficking. Slave labor means whole families are put to work 10, 12, 15 hours a day for barely subsistence wages, working in under horrible conditions, and it's true in every country. The most profitable business in the world is to be a sex trafficker. There are more than 1 million women and children who are under the control of a sex trafficking agent, a pimp, international pimp. Why is it so profitable? Because, again, they live on barely survival food conditions. They estimate it only costs $2,000 a year to keep one of these children or women alive. And each one of them, by having sex with men, make $34,000 a year profit. So that means each one of these million women bring in $32,000 a year profit. Times a million, that's profitable. And again, unlike drug trafficking, there's almost no legislation against it. There's almost no active policing of it. So a lot of the guys who used to do sex drug trafficking have now moved into sex trafficking. So these are what I call evils of action. These are doing things that harm other people. The last example I give is climate change disaster indifference. Right now, this weekend, on the whole East Coast, there are floods worse than there have been in hundreds of years. Last year in Boston, you remember, there was 9 feet more snow than they had in 100 years. In California, we have no snow. We have a huge drought. Places that were snow villages, ski resorts, are failing because there's no snow. Our crops are devastated. We're having these huge forest fires all over California because there's been no rain. Everything is burnt out. The pattern is now around the world, there are unexpected, dramatic changes in our climate that may be irreversible, may be too late. But even now, there are people who are arguing we shouldn't do anything about it. It's nature run a little amok. And the reason is always profit. They're saying it's going to cost too much money to install special devices in our smokestacks to minimize carbon dioxide, et cetera, et cetera. And the businesses put pressure on the lobbyists who put pressure on politicians, and the politicians say, "We, no way." To his credit, Obama has been pushing it, but unless he gets sufficient support from Congress, there will be no new legislation. And they keep talking about, well, in 2020 or 2050, it's too late. I think it's going to be too late for many of you. We now know that in the Arctic, huge glaciers are now melting. And so everybody's saying, oh great, there's going to be new transportation in places that were, you know, all glazed over. And so we'll have access to new oil wells and so forth and so on. For every good thing that happens from global climate change, there will be a tremendous disaster. I just came back from Polynesia, and it's the most beautiful place in the world, Bora Bora, Tahiti, all the places you hear about in your imagination. And on our cruise, the cruise master said, see this beautiful island, and this one, little one, that one. In 5 years, they will disappear. We know the water is rising at, you know, a foot a year. And in 5 years, the entire island, with all people's houses, with all their industry, whatever, will disappear. And the French government is doing nothing about it. Okay. So here again is the thing which was striking. Amid all this beauty and the most clear blue water, Nevertheless, the climate change is producing this future negative disaster. So I want to switch now to two examples that you know about. I'm going to present slightly differently about situational evil. The first is by the question asked, would you electrocute a stranger if someone asked you to? And could the Holocaust happen again in America? Okay. Those are heavy-duty questions. They were actually asked by a little Jewish kid in the Bronx, Stanley Milgram. He asked them when we were in the same class, 1948 and 49 and 50 in the Bronx. And essentially, this is little Stanley. It wasn't that 1948 is not that far from the Second World War. And he thought, you know, could, as a Jew, could he end up in a concentration camp? He said, don't be stupid, Stanley. We're Americans. We're not like those people. He said, I'll bet they said the same thing. I'll bet until they got involved in the situation, they said, no, we're not that kind of people. We're good Germans. So his study was considered the most unethical study in psychology. It's still written up in all ethics examinations until I did mine. But I want you to take a minute. Here's what Stanley says about why he did this research. Here is this incredibly moral reason for doing what people have considered immoral research.
When I learn of incidents such as the massacre of millions of men, women, and children perpetrated by the Nazis in World War II, how is it possible, I ask myself, that ordinary people were courteous and decent in everyday life? Can act callously, inhumanely, without any limitations of conscience. Now, there are some studies in my discipline, social psychology, that seem to provide a clue to this question. The problem I wanted to study was a little different. It went a little bit further. It was the issue of authority. Under what conditions would a person obey authority who commanded actions that went against conscience?
So that's the question to ask about the Milgram study. Under what circumstances would people obey an authority figure who gave you orders that went against your moral conscience? So it's not somebody saying, you know, we want you to, you know, litter or pick up, do some little thing. No, we want you to do something that violates your moral conscience. So in his study, as you now know very well, two men come to his laboratory at Yale, two men ages 20 to 50. In fact, in his study, he ran 1,000 participants. It's most subjects ever run in any experiment. 500 were done at Yale, and 500 he did at Bridgeport, Connecticut, a small town about an hour away where they make Bridgeport tires. He did it because he was getting such profound effects. He wasn't sure whether the effect was the authority figure or the authority of Yale. So these men, and he said no high school or college age men, 20 to 50 years old. So these are normal, average people from a small town in America. When you get there, there's two of you. You flip a coin, and one of you is going to be the teacher, one of you is going to be the learner. Simple. Teacher gives learner something to learn. Learner gets it right. Teacher rewards him. Learner gets it wrong. Teacher punishes him. So the cover story, the lie of Milgram's study was, we want to understand whether or not punishment can improve memory. We want to help people improve their memory. The subtext is we're going to help by hurting. So in fact, in much evil, the key is the semantics. Nobody ever does evil. Nobody. In their own mind and in the way they portray it. So you have to understand the semantics from George Orwell, how it's framed, because that's the important thing you have to realize when you want to combat evil. The experimenter then, in a white lab coat, actually it was a gray lab coat, is the authority figure, and he tells the learner who's in another room that, you know, he tells the learner that when you get something right, you get rewarded. When you get wrong, you're going to get punished electric shock. The teacher is in another room, and he's in front of this huge shock generator that has 30 switches. The first switch is 15 volts, and each increment is 15 volts. And that's the brilliant part of Milgram's study. It's the gradual increase in pain that you hardly notice, 15, 30, 45. So each level you're at is only a little different than where you were. So 45 is only a little different than 30. 70 is a little different than 40. So at any point, it's a very gradual descent into hell. Once you start, it goes worse and worse. Now what happens is once it gets in the 100 level, the guy in the other room starts screaming, says, I got a heart condition, please let me out. I don't want to continue. In every single case, in every one of the 100,000 people who ran, they always turn the experiment and say, sir, I don't want to go on, I don't want to hurt anybody. So people are not indifferent to suffering of others, but in every case the experiment says, I'm sorry, you have a contract, you have to continue. And in order to get out of the study, you have to protest three times. That was Milgram's rule. You say, I quit, I don't want to go on, I quit. And this continues. Now, when it gets up to 375 volts, the guy screams, thud, silence. Imagine you are the teacher. You turn to the experimental lab, say, sir, something is wrong. He's not responding. He might be unconscious. Experiment says, it doesn't matter. A failure to respond is an error of omission, which is the same as an error of commission. Keep shocking. At that point, I want all of you to imagine you were in that experiment. What is going on now? How could the study be about improving his memory if he's unconscious or dead? Can't be. So now you say, hello, the study is about me. The study is about me, will I obey? It should have been obvious to all of them. Interestingly, it was not obvious to any of them. At that point, everybody should have quit. Say, I'm sorry. If you get up to 375 volts, nobody quits. Everybody goes to 450, the last level. In fact, Milgram, in his paradigm, makes you press the last button twice, 450 volts. Okay. So I put together, Milgram did 19 different experiments. In each experiment, he varied one independent variable. And I could only fit 16 on. I'll describe very briefly. What he found was that two of every three people, 65%, went all the way to 450 volts. What's interesting about that is before Milgram did his study, he described the study to 40 psychiatrists, I think, at the New Haven Medical School, and asked, what percent of American citizens will go all the way? 1%, they said on average, because that is psychopathic behavior. And we know that only 1% of American citizens are psychopathic. What's wrong with that analysis? Psychiatrists know nothing about human behavior. That's bottom line. Zero, zero, zero. And even worse, now, I'll say it publicly, most psychiatrists are drug pushers now. If you go to a psychiatric session, you get drugs, and you pay $200 or $250 an hour, your hour is 12 minutes or 15 minutes, and you come back every 2 weeks to get your drugs adjusted. What did they fail to do? They failed to notice any of the situational variables, the white lab coat, the roles, teacher learning, the semantics, you're helping somebody by hurting, the rules, what you can and cannot do. So they ignored all of that, and they made the dispositional analysis. It's psychopathic behavior, therefore only psychopaths would do it. They said 1%, the average is 65, so they couldn't be more wrong. However, if you see, now Milgram, people complain women would behave differently. In study 13, you see the female sign, women were identical to men. So he did do a study with women. The most important thing to take away from the Milgram study is not, gee, two-thirds of people went all the way. It's comparing study number 5 with study number 16. So in study 16, you come in, you answer, the ad was in the New Haven Register. You answer, I'm here for the study, so sit down. We're running a little late. Why don't you sit down, you can watch the previous subject. You see somebody like you go all the way to 450 volts and say, okay, now it's your turn. Under those circumstances, we have a negative role model, 91% go all the way. It goes from 65 to 91%. Well, obviously, what happens if we do it the other way? You come in, you sit down, you come in and says, hey, we're running a little late. You see somebody like you resist, say, I quit, and walks out. Under those circumstances, 90% refuse. So you flip it completely by having role models who model evil behavior or heroic behavior. So for me, this is the main point of the study. And for each of us, it says, imagine it was an experiment. Imagine, in fact, you were in that study and you observed this behavior. It means that each of us has a ripple effect. What you do that other people notice has an influence on them that you may be unaware of. When you do something wrong, when you violate a law, and other people notice, especially if you're an adult and children notice, they are more likely to follow. On the other hand, when you do something good, compassionate, and I'm going to talk later, heroic, you implant in their mind, you inspire them to do something positive and heroic. So all evil begins with 15 volts. By that, once you press that first button, that you see, the box is before you. Why would they have a box with all these buttons? Why would they have 450 volts that says, danger, severe shock, you know, triple X, if they didn't expect somebody to go there? So in fact, of the 1,000 subjects that Milgram ran, only one person of 1,000 refused to press the first button. And I asked Milgram about it. He followed it up. And it was a guy who said, I can't do it because I know if I press the first one, it's going to be easy for me to go all the way, and I don't want to hurt somebody. He actually became a journalist. I followed him up later. He since then has died. But so nobody resisted. I'm going to argue that that first button is exactly like working in a corporation. It's Friday night. It's called Enron, and the books are not balancing. And what are you going to do? You tell the accountant, look, just change a few numbers. We'll correct it on Monday. It's not cooking the books, it's just warming the books a little, okay? So that's the 15, and then Monday, things are running out of control. So you say, you tell your accountant, Arthur Anderson, you have to do a little more extreme. It's not balancing. And suddenly you have a full set disaster. I bet the same thing is happening now with Volkswagen. But I want to go back in time, since Milgram was concerned about the Holocaust. And I want to give you a special example that I created. This is the first time I'm showing this anywhere. You remember that the Nazis, in their first step of Nazification, in their extermination of Jews, the first step was they forced all Jewish people to wear a yellow Star of David, okay, that you had to wear prominently. People said, what's the difference? You know, so yeah, I'm a Jew, I'm proud of it. But that was the 15 volts. Because once you did that, then you're identified, and then each success, then what was going to be 45, what was going to be 75, what was going to be 100. And so what I did is, with the aid of a Hungarian buddy of mine, who created the shirt I'm going to show you in a minute, who's a tech guy, we created the Milgram Jewish Shock Box. And you're going to see how we go from 15 volts with this wearing a star to ending up in a concentration camp, exterminated. I hope it's going to work. Yellow badge, 15 bucks. Restricted work. Restricted housing. No schooling allowed. Jews are like vermin, the propaganda. Forced into ghettos, imported to concentration camps, final extermination, killing of 2 million Jews. So essentially, this is the update of the Milgram shock box in everyday life in Nazi Germany. So that first little step is the one that you have to challenge. The first little step, for example, often is you had a family gathering. You got this favorite Uncle Charlie, who always tells this story about comparing, you know, the Guineas, the Jews, and Spics, you know, da-da-da, or they tell the story about tits and ass, and people laugh awkwardly. That's 15 volts. What is your job? How do you get Uncle Charlie not to tell that story anymore and not to be defensive? That's called developing a courageous conversation, one of the things we teach in our Hero Project. You got to get them to stop. I get it every time I go to New York in a cab. They said, did you hear the joke about, you know, the stupid Polish da-da-da, or whatever it is. In the cab, it's in New York, and with a guy, it's always a sex thing. You have to say, I'm sorry, I wish you wouldn't say that. It's upsetting me. Or imagine somebody heard that who was Jewish and black or whatever. You have to do something. The reason we don't do those things is simple. It's awkward. We get embarrassed. We get embarrassed by doing the right thing, and later you feel shame for not having done the right thing. We'll talk more about that in a minute. So next, a classic example of situational evil that I created, ye old Stanford Prison Experiment. So this was done in 1970. It's just astounding. It's 44 years ago in the basement at Stanford University. We put an ad in the Palo Alto newspaper. And the ad simply says, I wanted college students. I wanted bright, intelligent college students, college age. And we did this at the middle of August 14th, 1971, because we knew a lot of kids would have just finished summer school at Berkeley, at Stanford, at University of San Francisco, would have 2 weeks to do nothing, because in those days, a new term didn't start till after Labor Day. So we knew we'd have a lot of available. 75 people answered the ad. They came down to our office. We gave them a battery of personality tests, 6 tests from the Comrie Personality Inventory, because unlike Milgram's study, we wanted to know up front that we had only good apples. So we picked only people who were most normal, most healthy, and there were 24. 12 were going to be guards, 12 were going to be prisoners. And we flipped a coin, so it's purely random, actually random number. At any one time, there's going to be 3 prisoners in each of 3 cells, and 3 standby prisoners to replace in case somebody got sick. And there's going to be 3 guards in each of 3 8-hour shifts. And we have 3 backup guards. So that's why we say 12 and 12, but at any one time, there's 9 guards and 9 prisoners. The prisoners were dehumanized. They made anonymous. They became a number. Each one was given a number, and that's who they were. And shortly, when you ask them, who are you, they'd say 8612-9473. They became their number. So that's the first step in de-individuating them. The other thing is, instead of uniforms, they wore dresses with no underpants. What is that? We wanted to diminish their masculinity. We wanted to make it easier for the guards to control them, so that a man without underpants and a dress stands like this, like girls do, rather than like this. So immediately, from the first moment, we are changing their self-image, their self-identity. The guards had these fancy military uniforms, billy clubs, symbols of power, handcuffs, and then they all had, when everybody interacted with the prisoners, we had silver reflecting sunglasses. So that by not seeing your eyes, it added to the dehumanization. Where did I get that idea from? The movie Cool Hand Luke. The movie is all about those silver reflecting sunglasses. And so if the movie had just come out, I saw that and put it in. At the beginning, on day one, nothing happened. Literally on the night of day one, I said, forget, nothing's happening. Why? Because nobody wanted to be a guard. It's 1971. Nobody wanted to be a cop, because cops were brought on college campuses, like Kent State, some of you here from Kent State, like Stanford University campus, because we were all protesting against the evil of the Vietnam War. And cops came on campus and beat up college kids. And so we hated cops, we students and faculty, and guards were extension of cops. And also you didn't go to college to become a prison guard. So the first day, nothing happened. In fact, you hear the recording. They're saying, come on, take it seriously. This is really important. And literally, at the end of the first day, I told my assistants, Craig Haney, Kurt Banks, I said, look, this is not working. You know, if nothing changes, you know, we'll close it down. We made a mistake. The next morning, the prisoners revolted. They barricaded themselves in the cell. They ripped off their numbers. Instead of cutting their hair, we had them wear women's nylon stocking caps. We just wanted to minimize the individuality. And then they made the mistake behind the bars, cursing the guards to their face. One of the guards was little. He said, you little ass, when I get out, I'm going to kick your ass. At that moment, the guard said, these are dangerous prisoners. Not students like me in a dress. These are dangerous prisoners. And they said to me, what are we going to do? I said, it's your prison. What do you want? They said, we need reinforcements. So we called in all 12 guards. They broke down the doors. They dragged the prisoners out. It was the only time there was physical confrontation. And I couldn't stop it because the prisoners were fighting back. They stripped all the prisoners naked. They put them in solitary confinement. They tied them up, some of them. And suddenly this thing exploded. So suddenly this was wholly different thing. From that moment, nobody used the word experiment for the next week. It was a prison run by psychologists. In 36 hours, the first prisoner to get arrested, and I'll mention that in a moment, had a nervous breakdown, screaming, crying, irrational thinking. What made the study work, which is really unique, is I realized that to create this prison mentality, we had to have the authorities take away your freedom, rather than you come and say, I'm here for the study, which means you're giving up your freedom temporarily. I knew once the shit hit the fan, you say, I quit. Okay. But now what's going to happen is the boys who are going to be prisoners, we say, wait at home, wait in the dormitories. Study is going to begin on Sunday. A police car comes, siren wailing, a cop comes, says, Billy Johnson, you wanted for violation of Penal Code 459 PC, armed robbery, a breaking and entry. You have the right to, he reads the Miranda rights, handcuffs him, puts him next to the squad car, does a body search, puts him in the squad car, neighbors are looking around, brings him to a real police station, does fingerprinting, photographing, puts him in a real prison cell, and then blindfolds them. Then my graduate students come, take them, put him in our car, bring them down to Stanford jail, and suddenly they're standing there naked with a blindfold. Take the blindfold off. You are now a prisoner in a Stanford County jail. So that powerful impact, they knew they had done what the officer said, but nevertheless made you feel guilty. In fact, later on in the study, I had a prison chaplain come down to interview the prisoners. And in every case, he said, what's your name, son? I'm Father Coughlin. They gave the number, 861-23579, etc. Then he said, why are you here? And they all said, what the cop had said, armed robbery, breaking and entry, like that. And then he says, what are you doing to get out? They look at me, I look at him. He said, what do you mean? He is now a Catholic priest who is a prison chaplain who now knows this experiment, but he's now in his role as prison chaplain. What does he say? You're in jail. You got to get a lawyer to get out. I'm saying, I thought it was like a joke. And essentially, he made the study more real than anything else, because clearly he's not one of the experiments. He's got his white clerical collar. And essentially, he says, you need a lawyer. And can I help you? So one kid says, yeah, my cousin's a public defender. He said, give me his number, I'll call him. And he calls the lawyer. He says, your nephew's in jail. He needs your help. He knows it's an experiment. He knows I invited him just to see how realistic it is. So again, he made the study more realistic, more of a real prison and less of an experiment. Now, here's a parallel between Stanford Prison Study and Abu Ghraib. We had parole board hearings headed by an ex-convict. And when a prisoner wanted to be paroled, he write a report why he wanted to be paroled. The guards wrote a report why he should not. And then they put bags over their head, chained them, and they sat outside a conference room. And in the parole board was some of our staff, but also secretaries, other people not connected with the study. And now next to it is Abu Ghraib prison. You remember that in 2004, American soldiers in Abu Ghraib prison in Iraq were identified with a dozen pictures were doing humiliating, degrading things to prisoners while they were laughing. So here's a parallel. In fact, this picture is the iconic image of torture now around the world. The guy who thought of this is a guy named Chip Frederick, namely to put a prisoner standing on a box. This is a stress position that Donald Rumsfeld said you should use to prepare prisoners for interrogation. You stand on a box for hours until your legs give out. What they added, he and Sabrina Harmon, one of the women on the night shift, was that they told this guy, they put on electrodes, and that when he fell off, he would electrocute himself. But as you can see, the electrodes didn't go anywhere. And they thought it would be funny when he falls off, thinking he was going to be killed himself, nothing would happen. So this is the image of losing compassion for the guy underneath the hood, who thinks that I'm going to self-execute myself. When I fall off, when my body gives way, it's going to have to, at some point, I will kill myself. And the little picture down there is another one of the female guards dragging a prisoner around by his neck, naked as a dog on a leash. So what happened was horrendous. They showed 12 of these pictures. There were actually more than 1,000, and there's also videos. So here's a situational variable. 9 of 9 guards on the night shift did those bad things. meaning they did the horrible things and put themselves in the pictures, piling prisoners up naked in a pyramid. Zero guards on the day shift did anything negative. That's situational. Same prison, same place. What happened was, shortly after our President Bush announced mission accomplished, we won the war, the next day there started to be improvised explosive devices blowing up our Humvees, blowing up tanks, killing soldiers. And they didn't have a clue, meaning they, the CIA, the FBI, the military. So they started arresting all the men and boys around in the explosion, putting them in Abu Ghraib prison. And they started interrogating them, and they got nothing. They got nothing partly because the interrogators were unskilled. The interrogators didn't speak the language. They had to go through translators. And the only time interrogation works is when you develop psychological rapport between the interviewer and the interviewee. So the head of military intelligence goes to the head of military police and says, we want you guys on the night shift to take off the gloves. We want them to do whatever is necessary so that when we interrogate them, they'll give us actionable intelligence, meaning they'll spill the beans. And then in 3 months, no senior officer ever went down to the dungeon at night. In the daytime, there were all senior officers there. So here's the biggest situational difference imaginable. So I was an expert witness for Chip Frederick, that guy. And in my testimony to the court, I said, Chip Frederick is guilty as charged. He's in the pictures. He did bad stuff. But everything I know about him, studying his whole background, meeting him personally, meeting his family, I can assert, with all my psychological background, that he never would have done what he did unless the military put him in an impossible situation. I described how horrible the situation was for him and the others. And so his sentence should be mitigated. So the situational defense is not, you're not responsible, blame the situation. No. You're always personally responsible for your behavior, all time. But if you can show that you never would have done this except that you were put in this situation, then the severity of your sentence should be reduced or mitigated. And it was. I was able to cut his sentence in half from, 15 years to 8, then finally we got it reduced to 4. But he still served 4 years hard time in prison. So interestingly, there were a dozen investigations of what happened in Abu Ghraib, and I read all of them for my testimony. One of them is by James Schlesinger, who's Secretary of Defense before Rumsfeld. And he said, psychologists have attempted to understand, his report, psychologists have attempted to understand how and why individuals and groups who usually act humanely can sometimes act otherwise in certain circumstances. That's the Lucifer effect. And then he says, the landmark Stanford study provides a cautionary tale for all military detention operations. It should have been so. What he's saying, if you give anyone power with no oversight, with no limits, it's a recipe for abuse everywhere. There's no question. So this was in this document. It's available. Appendix D. In Lucifer Effect, I give the citation where you can find it. So this is a great cartoon that sums up what I've said so far, and we move on to the positive. Two off-duty cops are talking. One says, I'm neither a good cop nor a bad cop, Jerome, like yourself. I'm a complex amalgam, a mix of positive and negative personality traits that emerge or not, depending on the circumstances. So that's the situational rule. A study at the University of Michigan a few years ago with 1,500 children ages 8, 11, and 14 found that Middle Eastern children exposed to ethnic political violence in the Middle East become more aggressive than matched children. Violence in your environment promotes child aggression. And they showed that it's worse for 8-year-old kids than 11 and 14. The younger you are as a child that you experience aggression, the more likely it is that you become aggressive yourself. You play games of aggression, and when you have the opportunity, you become aggressive. Similarly, another study reported last year on situational power. A study of over 1,200 children from 9 countries around the world reveals the negative impact of growing up in dangerous neighborhoods. That's not poor, that's neighborhoods which are under bombardment, under threat. And it turns out, and under those conditions, parents use much more harsh parenting techniques, and the children become even more aggressive than matched samples. So the Lucifer effect that some of you read and some of you are going to read, that you just bought tonight, has 15 chapters of evil. It was the most painful thing I ever did. It took 2 years to write. It's not only about the prison study, the Milgram study, about the Holocaust, about Rwanda, about, I mean, I was seeped in evil. And so the last chapter, you should begin with chapter 16 and work back. The last chapter was, I said, nobody's going to read this. It's overwhelming. I was like, you know, like, you're up to here in liquid evil shit. But then I said, you know what? Really, if I step back, it's really a celebration of the human mind's infinite capacity to make any of us be kind or cruel, to be caring or indifferent. Some of us become destructive and some of us become creative. And it pushes some of us to be villains, to do the most despicable things imaginable, to behead people publicly, or to become heroes. And that's where we're going to go next. So are there circumstances that can make ordinary people do good things? Or is it all in our God-given, devil-given nature? So some people believe everything is nurture. Obviously, I believe everything is nature. I believe most things are nurture. So there's no evidence that there's an evil gene or a good gene in us. Rather, the issue is much more, we can be shaped by the environment and shaped by people who inspire us to do good. So what makes ordinary people do heroic deeds? Obviously, more courage, they're more mindful, they should be more compassionate, they're more empathic, they have a higher level of morality. We do not have an answer to the question, why? Two words that are missing in every single psychology textbook are hero and heroism. Two words that are missing from Marty Seligman's Human Strengths and Virtues, like 300 pages that he did with Peterson, because, and I challenged Marty, who's a friend of mine, he said, compassion, empathy are private virtues. Heroism is a civic virtue. I said, Marty, who gives a shit if I'm lying, bleeding, and you come over and you say, I feel your suffering. Pick me up, yell help, or get the hell out of here. So my argument is, compassion must be transformed into heroic action to combat evil. Evil is here to stay, there's no question about it. Compassion is the first step, but it's a feeling. Empathy is a feeling, compassion is a kind of cognitive structure. It has to be linked to action, and that's where heroism comes in. The line dividing good and evil cuts through the center of every human heart. That line shifts inside of us. This is by a Soviet dissident, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who was put in the worst prison, Gulag Archipelago. And I want to show these pictures. Here's Hitler one side with his adoring masses. Here's Gandhi with his adoring masses. And the question is, which leader would you follow? I want to argue it all depends on where you happen to be born by accident, what crowd you happen to be in. So our kids have heroes. I had heroes when I was a little kid. These are our superheroes. When I talk to high school kids, I say, you know what? It's really great to have a hero. These are wrong for you. What do you mean wrong? Every kid has something that no superhero has. Some can fly, some can climb buildings, some can swim. What? Some can swim underwater. What they lack is a brain. You have a brain. With your brain, you can create superheroes. They are the product of a cartoonist's brain. So you are a creation. You can create. They are someone's creation. So that think of that. Your brain makes you a special kind of superhero that can do the kinds of things I'm going to show you in a minute. So what is a hero? My definition of a hero is someone who acts on behalf of others in need or in defense of a moral cause. What makes it heroic is the next part. It's action you take aware that there are consequences to you. You could die. You could get hurt. If you're a whistleblower hero, you could lose your job. You don't get promoted. The interesting thing about most heroes, they're humble and modest. Almost in every case, when you say, oh, that was heroic, they will say, no, I did what I had to do. I was going to show you an example in a moment. New York subway hero, Wesley Autry. They say, no, they disown the label. Also, nobody can say, hey, what I did was heroic. So heroism is always a social attribution. Somebody else has to say what you did was really heroic. And I want to argue that every day in every city, in every country of the world, there are many, many people doing heroic deeds that we're unaware of. And the only way we get become aware of if somebody happens to make a video and puts it on YouTube. And then you say, oh my God, here's this guy, these veterans who stopped a massacre in Paris on the train, a guy last week in Oregon Community College who died protecting other people. But those are dramatic ones. I'm going to show you some ordinary heroes in a minute. So the new conception of heroes is democratize, demystify, diffuse. Democratize means anyone can be a hero. Demystify, there's no special inequalities, no family background. Our usual view of heroes comes from literature. When I was a kid, the heroes were from Greek myth. Agamemnon, Achilles, samurai warriors. It was always men, male, warrior, killers, okay? Generals whose army defeated the other. You can't be a general, you can't, except for, what's it, Jefferson, in the Civil War. You can't be a general if you lose the war, okay? Even if you fought a good fight. The other thing is, I want to move away from the solo hero, I want to diffuse, away from solo heroes to team or ensemble heroes who work in pro-social networks. And I'm going to give you an example of a woman who did this incredibly well. I call it hero squads. Moral courage, not physical courage, is at the core of heroic action. We need heroes for many reasons. They shift the norm from being passive compliance to pro-social action. True heroes put their best selves forward in service to humanity. They represent ideals that any one of us can aspire to. They are really the force of good that opposes evil in all of its many forms. The evil of action, as we talked about, and the evil of inaction, which is revealed in public apathy and indifference, as I'll show again in a moment. So what does it take to be a hero? Again, in the past, people say heroes are born. In Milton, a lot of the classic works on heroism, they're different people, they're special, they have some inner quality, some magic. I want to say heroes are ordinary people, everyday people, whose actions in challenging situations are extraordinary. So we interviewed President Obama a few years ago, asking him about this. You have to be a special person to be a hero. And he gives a one-minute answer, which is, you know, really beautifully eloquent in its simplicity. And he says the importance of standing up, speaking out, and the ripple effect of our actions.
You know, what's remarkable about history is ordinary people doing extraordinary things. You know, last year Rosa Parks passed away, and you know, I remember sitting on this stage with world leaders and Bill Clinton and senators and governors and thinking we were all paying homage to a seamstress who had transformed the country and helped transform the world. You know, we never know sort of how our actions are going to ripple over time. But each of us can take some responsibility for making sure that we are pushing a little bit in the direction of justice and in the direction of equality and the direction of tolerance. And when we do that, we may surprise ourselves with the amount of influence that in fact we have just by standing up or speaking up.
So that's really the basic message of my new organization. Here's Rosa Parks, if you didn't know about it. She was a seamstress, meaning she repaired and made dresses for rich women in Atlanta, Georgia. And one day she refused to get up and give a seat to a white guy. She said, I paid the same money. She got arrested. The picture below is here she is as a prisoner, prison 7053. But she started the civil rights movement that changed desegregation in transportation in America. Here's a Polish woman. She's actually my favorite hero of all time. During the Nazi occupation of Poland, they created a ghetto in Warsaw, the capital of, and they, in this ghetto, which was 100 square blocks, they rounded up 400,000 Jews from all over Poland and put them in this ghetto. They put them on a starvation diet of 120 calories a day, a potato, a piece of bread, and something else. It was not enough to live on. And the idea was that children, old people would die, they'd get rid of them, and everybody who survived, they would ship to concentration camps. They had to do that because they didn't have enough transport to ship all of them. And so she heard about this. She was a social worker and went in to see for herself, and she saw this, the starvation, and she saw the impossible situation. So she went to the rabbi and said, me and my friends would like to help the children escape. the rabbi spoke to the people, and they said, no way, we're not going to give our kids to Christian women we don't even know. And kids started dying, and she kept going back. And finally, the rabbi convinced the people to do this. And she said, I promise that when this is all over, I will do my best to reunite you with your children. We'll put your name in a bottle in a jar and hide it. And so what she did was she organized a network of 19 people, 18 women and one guy. So women are effective in creating social networks because women live in social networks. Guys are much more likely to be loner as heroes. And they smuggled out 2,500 kids in 1 year. Now, that's 50 years later, those kids have had kids, and 10,000 people, 10,000 Jews around the world owe their life to this Irina Sendler. So she should have been a great hero. What happened was, when the Nazis left, the communists came in, and they were also anti-Semitic. So everybody said, don't mention it. And it wasn't until a few years ago that Israel identified her, Yad Vashem, identified her as one of the righteous among Gentiles, and gave her, in quote, hero status. And she at least lived a few years. This is a picture of her as an old lady, able to enjoy the acclaim that she deserved. If you watched the Olympics in Beijing, you saw a huge basketball player from the Houston Rockets carrying a little kid on his shoulder, blocking on his name. Yao Ming. And a little kid on his shoulder. Who's that kid? This was the kid, Lin Hao. He was 9 years old. Just before the Olympics, there was an earthquake in Sichuan province, the same place where that Sichuan tobacco school is. Because of shoddy construction, the ceilings on many of the schools collapsed, killing many of the children. He happened to be near the door. He ran out. As he's running out, he hears two kids yelling. He goes back and saves them. He gets interviewed, and people say, why did you do that? Why did you risk your life? His answer is wonderful. I was the hall monitor. It was my job to look after my classmates. So that's what I call putting the heroic action, heroic imagination into action. It means it's going to happen once in a lifetime. How many of us were hall monitors waiting for that ceiling to collapse so you could be... it's not going to... But the point is, when it happens, it's going to happen rarely. The point is, you will have one chance to act. And if you don't act properly, you will always regret that for the rest of your life. So here's the most incredible hero of all. This is Wesley Autry. A few years ago, he's standing on a subway in New York City with his two little daughters. And subways, if you live in New York, you know subways come in every 3 minutes. And a white guy is stumbling and falls across the tracks. Across the tracks. This guy's going to get cut in half. He looks around. There's 75 people on the platform who freeze. That's called a bystander effect. We'll talk about it. Do nothing. He turns to a stranger, says, take care of my kids. Jumps down. It's like 6 feet. Takes the guy from across the tracks, puts him between the tracks, lays on top, presses him down, and the train is going to go over their head. This is what it looks like. Afterwards he said, I did what anyone could do, and I did what everyone ought to do. So that's the moral imperative. So this is the last hero before we move on. This is a woman named Christina Maslach. She was my graduate student at Stanford. And after she graduated, she got a job at Berkeley, graduated in June, had a job at Berkeley, and we started dating. The idea is we live together, and if it worked out, we would get married. She comes down on Thursday night and sees the 10 o'clock toilet run. This is the time when guards line up the prisoners, the last time they could go to the toilet. After that, they had to go to a bucket in the cell, which they hated to do. But the guards used that as an occasion for humiliation, put bags over their head, chained their legs one to each other, yelling, cursing, pushing. I look up, and it's a check mark on my daily schedule. It's the 10 o'clock toilet run, nothing more. She looks up and starts tearing. And I'm saying, hey, Chris, look at this. It's amazing. She says, I can't look. And she runs out. And we have this big argument in front of the Jordan Hall, the Stanford Psych Department. And I'm telling her about the power of the situation. She says, stop. These are not prisoners. They're not guards. They're boys. And they are suffering. And it's your fault. And I keep going on telling her, no, you don't understand. You're too sensitive. And she says, wait a minute, how could you see what I just saw and not be upset? And then she said, you know what, you have changed. The power of the situation has changed you, that you have become the prison superintendent, which is the other role I was playing in addition to researcher. And she said, if this is the real you, I don't want to continue our relationship. And at that point, it was, I said, oh my God, you're right. It was literally like a wake up from a nightmare. I said, you're right. You know, how could I have done that? And again, I did it because, like the Milgram study, it was hour by hour, day by day, shift by shift, night by night. And so I became the prison superintendent. I kept saying, no physical force, but I allowed this incredibly horrible psychological force to occur. I never minimized what the guards were doing. And at that point, I said, you're right. We have to end the study, and we'll do it the next day, the next Friday morning. And so that was heroic. She's saying, I'm willing to give up a lifetime relationship with you on the basis of this moral principle. She never said you have to end the study. She said, you know, if this is, and she said, you're a caring, loving teacher. Everybody knows that. And I had forgotten all of that. So the question is, what are you going to do with somebody who challenges your authority? I married her. Actually, the next year in the Stanford Chapel, and we've lived 44 years happily married, and we have two wonderful kids. So with that, I've given up evil. No more dining in hell. From now on, I will only promote goodness and heroism in my new life. So the Heroic Imagination Project is a San Francisco-based nonprofit I started about 6 years ago. We promote what Obama said. We teach people how to stand up, speak out, change the world. Our program is based on the premise that ordinary people are capable of taking extraordinary action. We've developed a unique, revolutionary educational program I'll describe in a minute. We have six lessons, and within each lesson, they're the same activities. It's designed mostly for high school and middle school. It could be in colleges. And we think, hopefully, we want to extend it to professional organizations as well. So our modules, and we worked a long time, it's really basic social psychology. We call it understanding human nature. So one is based on Carol Dweck's mindset. How do you transform people who have a fixed mindset? I'm good at A, B, and C, I'm not good at D, E, F. And you impose it on other people. Women are not good at math, blacks are not good at this, migrants are not good at such and such. How do you change that to a growth mindset where everything is improvable with practice and effort? That's a fundamental change in thinking. We have a whole lesson on that. We have a lesson on the bystander. How do you transform passive bystanders who see somebody lying on the street hurting and pass by into an active hero? And then how do you transform prejudice and discrimination into understand? So we have six of these lessons. Each lesson we developed, we spent over a year for each one, 18 to 30 pages each with references. But the most important thing is each of these lessons have the same eight activities, and they're all based around videos. So young people live in a visual world, so the videos are captivating, and teachers don't lecture anymore. Teachers are like coaches. Students are like their athletes. Instead of teachers thinking, I have smart kids and dumb kids, no, these are your athletes. Your job is to bring them all up to the best of their ability, okay? And instead of having class discussions, the way you answer is in pairs, a boy and a girl in dyads. Teacher asks a question, you talk among yourself. Because I know, shy kids never answer in class, boys almost never answer in class. So these are the ideas. What would you do? Explore the power of situation. Think of a time when you did it, didn't do something. Decide for yourself. Develop effective change-making strategy. Plan for your next challenges. Reflect on what you're going to take away, and then spread the word. In this program, every student becomes a teacher. Once a student's a teacher, they know the material and remember it much more. So the evil of inaction, for example, the bystander effect. Individuals do not help a person in need when others are present. The paradox is the more people present, the less likely anyone is to help. So if you're lying there hurt, what you got to hope is only one person's around. When there's a lot of people, you're not going to get help. It's called diffusional responsibility. Others define the norm is do nothing, don't get involved. But the new hip approach gives people a label. So now you know, hey, that's the bystander effect. And that knowledge obligates you to take wise and effective action, and you become a social change agent. So what can you do? Practice being a positive deviant for a day. When one person joins to help in emergency, others join in, as you'll see, in 6 seconds. So be that one, the power of one. The power of two, be an ally, support those in need. Especially in school, kids are being discriminated against. The power of many. When you want to challenge something, you can't do it alone because the system will label you as a fanatic. Once you have two or three people who agree with you and together you say, we believe, then it becomes a point of view. And in democracies, we respect points of view. The last two things are act socially. Heroes are sociocentric. The enemy of heroism is egocentricity. The other thing is dare to be different. Practice being a positive deviant. So one exercise I do with my students, and it goes back here, is I say, put a black mark on your forehead, I don't know if you can see it, with an erasable Sharpie. And you're gonna leave it on for 8 hours. I can't see it, nothing's changed. Can you see it? Okay. When people see it, they get upset. Your mother gets upset. Your friends get upset. The person, the hash in line, and people get upset. You say, no, I'm just doing, I just feel like it. Don't bother. What you're gonna see is people get crazed. Why do they get crazed? They want you to be what they want you to be. And then suddenly you realize the music you like is the same music they like. The way you dress is the same way they dress. The way you carry your books. Suddenly realize what you think is your taste is really your friend's taste imposed on you. And in many things, your attitudes about a variety of things, about migrants, about different religions, is based on the pressure your friends put on you. So now your job is resist for 8 hours, erasing it. Because it's going to be really easy with the magic mark. You just go, and people are going to be put, and then you have to, see, the point is you walk around, nothing is different. You don't see it. But people can't help but look, you know, they're looking at this. And then finally, at the end of the day, you write a report. What did I do? How did I feel? How did other people respond? What did I learn? And again, you learn, I now have this power in me to resist these pressures to do what they want me to do. Because again, in the bystander effect, they want you to do nothing. They want you to mind your business. Don't get involved. In fact, especially mothers. Mothers are the enemy of heroism because they don't want their kids to get involved. They don't want to be killed. Anyway, so this is an activity that I hope you will think about trying and doing. So again, start with small steps. Make someone feel special every day. Give them a genuine compliment. Learn their name, use their name, hug where appropriate, especially if you're a Sicilian. So again, I would like to give that as a challenge for all of you. One, every day this coming week, give a stranger a justified compliment. So it's easy with women because they have, you know, jewelry, they have scarves, they have all kinds of stuff. But you start with the external and then you go to the internal, meaning, I really like what you said about that. It was really interesting. No student I know ever gives a compliment to a teacher. It's a disgrace. It's a disgrace. Because now you could do it anonymously. You could send an email. You could put a note in their box. You say, they know it. Teachers don't know it. The only teachers who know it are teachers who are not good because students will complain. I met a guy. I gave a talk at Annapolis in Baltimore. And some guy came up and said, I was in your class at NYU in 1962. I was flunking out. I hated school. I was going to quit. And I took your Psych 1 class. It changed my whole life. I'm now the head of medical research in Seattle. Da, 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 da. I said, hey, that's really wonderful. I'm glad to hear that. Aren't you glad I didn't die before you waited 30 years to tell me? What the fuck? But imagine. I changed his life, and he never told me. It's not like, gee, I liked your class, it was fun. No, if you say I changed your life, let me know. You think I would not, everybody says that, yeah. So again, an assignment for all the students here, give your teacher a compliment in the next term, this week. And also, when you see a stranger, one a week, think of some way you can compliment a stranger. And you do be doing, Zim's good deed. Always challenge the rule. Don't blindly obey authority. And always think, what is your ripple effect? You will make a difference in this world for positive or negative. So change your perspective. Me becomes we, I become us. To be my hero. So the decision to act heroically is a choice that many of us will be called upon to make at some point in time. And the question is that decision is only going to happen once. So you have to be ready for it and ready for action. So what we're trying to do is create a new heroic vision in which silence, apathy, and indifference is never an option. So it doesn't matter when everybody is doing the wrong thing or nothing. See, it's not they do the wrong thing. Some people do wrong things. The problem, most people do nothing. And your job is to do the right thing or something. So this is a commercial for Prezi, P-R-E-Z-I. It's a program created by two Hungarians that I work with. I just came back from Budapest, so working with them. And what Keynote and PowerPoint are, this aside, parenthesis, are digital slideshows. Prezi is putting all your ideas on a Google white map. And so you have this dynamic thing. You could focus on one, and here's the whole talk. And I could reverse this and say, oh, let me go back to highlight this or the other thing. So I encourage you to do it. So the world needs more heroes. Do or do not, says Yoda. There is no try. So heroism is the hope for a future where humanity rules as evil is diminished. So the question is, what will you do? When you pull aside, it doesn't say Superman. It says, I am an everyday hero. In fact, we're developing a T-shirt, Hero in Training. Hopefully we'll have it online. You can order it. So the Heroic Imagination Project, and I want to very quickly go through as the last thing is, so here's a sample of one of our programs. Now, we have our programs everywhere except in American high schools, because the high school teachers and principals say, we have kids are studying for the test. They don't have they can't waste time on this kind of stuff. So here's how I would be training teachers. We're going to talk about transforming bystander apathy into heroic action. So what is the Heroic Imagination Project? So again, we give a little background. Teach skills and awareness needed to make effective decisions in challenging situations. How? We provide knowledge, tools, strategies, and exercises based on scientific research. Our objectives is practice responding mindfully and wisely to unclear situations of emergency. Make a personal plan for responding safely and effectively in potential future bystander situations. And share what you have learned from the intervention with someone else in their environment. First a class partner, then someone outside the class, like a parent or a friend. Learning objectives. Describe the bystander effects. Spot some of the common psychological barriers to helping others. Recognize key dynamics of group psychology in such situations, including diffusion of responsibility, group ignorance, and spotlight effect. Respond appropriately to an emergency situation, given that crowds are less likely than a lone person to do so. In some cases, may offer no help at all or make things worse. The focus today, learn about the bystander effect. What is it? How do we want to transform bystanders? How to recognize this? What can you do about it? What will you do about it? And then we're going to have a lot of questions, feedback, and discussion. So I first want you to imagine this. You're walking down the street, and you're going to see a woman lying on the steps of a railroad station, and you're going to see people passing by, and you're going to see a clock starting. And the question is, what are the people thinking and doing?
Liverpool Street Station in London. A drunk lies on the pavement. In fact, he's our actor, Peter, but these passers-by aren't to know that. And since he looks the worse for wear, not critically ill, they ignore him. Helping would be inconvenient or even risky. He lies there for 20 minutes and no one raises an eyebrow. This time, we've dressed Peter as a respectable city gent. How long before he's rescued now that he looks the part?
Hello, sir. How are you today?
I'm all right, thanks.
6 seconds. She even calls him sir. And suddenly, everyone's a good Samaritan.
Do you suffer from epilepsy?
No.
While you're lying on the floor in the rain?
After a couple of minutes, even the police turn up.
I would just hate to be in his position of feeling ill and nobody helping and walking past, so I'd just like to check that he was okay.
I thought, well, it's wet, so he must really be ill because he's going to ruin his suit anyway.
Our actress Ruth takes Peter's place. She's not a drunk, but she's also not a city gent. How long before she gets help? Minutes have passed, and 34 people have passed.
People don't really want to know. They just haven't got the time. Well, they have got the time, they just don't want to get involved.
But it's more complicated than that. If the street were deserted, a passerby would probably go to the rescue. But these strangers have silently formed a temporary group with a rule. Don't help. This woman, for instance, has clearly spotted Ruth. But she conforms to the rule and does nothing.
You all right?
Watch what happens, though, when someone else helps.
You all right?
She suddenly finds herself in a different group with a new rule, to help.
She don't look well, does she?
You all right, yeah. Sure.
First I thought she was dead.
then I sort of checked to see if she was breathing or not. And I looked around and I couldn't believe that no one had noticed her, because there was a bloke sat there just absorbed in reading a newspaper.
Peter's now having the same problem. This time, we've swapped his suit for casual clothes. He's not drunk, and we've asked him to act like he's in pain.
Help! Help! Help me! Please, somebody! Help me! Help me, somebody! Please help me! Help me! Help me! Help me!
What did the people in the videos do? So the teachers are going to ask the students. What do you imagine they were thinking and feeling? Why do you think they acted the way they did? And the students talk among each other, and they also write answers. And then the next thing the teacher does is say, here's the bystander effect. I won't go through all of this. When a group of people is around, someone in need of help, and no one does, people begin to watch each other. It makes it harder to tell if something is really wrong. This causes confusion, delays helping, and is more likely as more people arise. That's called a bystander effect. Group ignorance is involved, the spotlight effect. And then think of a time, remember two situations. Think of a time when you help somebody in need. You write down, what was it? How did you feel? Now think of a time when you didn't help, and this is really hard. And it's almost always people are putting a time when a friend was being bullied and they did nothing. They didn't confront the bully, but worse, they didn't give their friend emotional support. They didn't say, I'm really sorry. And how do you feel? Shame. So the students talk to each other. They don't talk to the class, so they're more, but they also write it down. And then the next thing is to start, make a commitment that next time when you're in that situation, what will you do? So what are common situations? What are situations where we wise not to intervene? And they talk about this. And then what are safe ways to help? You always do something. If it's dangerous or you're uncertain, you call the police. If somebody's bleeding, you call an ambulance. Your job is to do something or you call for help. But you never do the unwise, dangerous thing. So then change-making strategy. Again, we say, what are the obstacles? In all behavior, there are obstacles that you have to be aware of. You're distracted in a hurry. There's group ignorance, diffusion of responsibility, spotlight effect. Helping could be difficult or dangerous. Reflection. Where have you seen these obstacles in the videos or in real life? What obstacles are most important to you? What can you do to overcome them? And then here's a summary. Actually, it's much more than this. Here's each obstacle. Here's a solution. Obstacle four, the spotlight effect. Remember the spotlight effect. Help anyway. Be aware, be the first, be specific. So this is a little bit, obviously there are eight videos for each of the eight steps. So students love it, teachers love it. It's a whole new way of introducing social psychology. We're talking about it, our label is understanding human nature. Because a lot of places we teach, they don't have a psychology, program. So let us work together to create a new generation of heroes in your school, in your business, your community, and around the world. So our program is in Flint, Michigan, which is, as you know, a depressed town outside of Detroit. But also, it's now, I just came back from Budapest. We are now in 1,000 high schools all over Budapest in remote areas where grocery men in little towns in the outskirts of Hungary are talking about the bystander effect or mindset. It's also in many places in Poland, where I also go regularly, and given Sicilian, I have a foundation in Italy, it's in Corleone, the godfather town. We're about to be in all over the UK. I just did a training there. And excitingly, I'm going to go next month to Bali. There's something called the Green School, where they have an international group of students. I'm going to teach them our lessons. And in return, we're going to develop a new lesson on conservation and sustainability. That's what the Green School is all about. So we are spreading our word. We hope to have a bigger impact in America if we can convince some school systems to try out our program. With that, if you want to get involved in our project, write to admin@heroicimagination.org. And I would like to do one last thing, and I know it's going to be awkward for many of you. I'm going to play a song by Diana Ross. And I'd like you to stand up, reach out, hold somebody's hand, and somebody come up and do it with me.